puntos de vista y las opiniones expresadas en este programa son de los participantes y no reflejan necesariamente las opiniones de BronxNet o sus colaboradores.
Welcome to this special edition of the Mexican Studies Oral History Project. I am Jose Higuera, the Deputy Director of the Mexican Studies Institute at CUNY. Today we have the pleasure of receiving Dr. Alex Chavez from the University of Notre Dame. Welcome and thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me.
So Alex, can you just tell us a little bit about how did you do your connection with this type of music, the music of Huapango Arribeño?
Sure. So I... what became the sort of research and the other projects that I they're doing with and around this music of Huapango Arribeño, a couple experiences that I had that kind of thrust me into this world. Well, one was I had this connection to it already as kind of my assumed heritage, because this music is from the states of Querétaro, San Luis Potosí, and Guanajuato, and part of my family is from Querétaro. And so I, you know, that was one connection that, you know, it was recognizable, familiar to me. Mm-hmm. But what ended up happening is I was living in Austin, Texas, where I did my PhD at the University of Texas at Austin. And I was playing some jarocho and other musics. And as happens when you do art and music, you know, meet different people and connect to different networks of musicians and practitioners. And I met some huapangueros, you know, and... That took me by surprise. I hadn't quite naively just imagined that this music would be practiced in a place like Central Texas. You know, I always sort of placed it in Mexico, and so here they were, musicians doing the work, making art, playing huapango, and I immediately sort of took to them as friends. Yeah, and so, and that's... See, those relationships emerged the research over several years. But those, you know, I already had a memory of it such that when I encountered these musicians, I knew what it was and I wanted to know more.
And once you started doing your research,
yeah,
what is the specific distinction of huapango?
Yeah, so first, the landscape of Mexican music is varied. It's huge. Number of different styles in Mexico alone. And so there are a few sort of super genres that a lot of us are familiar with. So if you turn on the radio and you hear, you know, Regional Mexicana, you'll hear like Música Norteña, right, accordion-based music from northern Mexico, or banda, right, the sort of brass, woodwind-based banda popular from the Pacific Coast. One other super genre, for instance, of Mexican music is what people call son. Son, and all that means son is string music. So unlike norteña, which is accordion based, or unlike banda, which is brass based, son is all string music, and there are different variants of it. Son jarocho from southern Veracruz, son de la tierra caliente from western Mexico, son ismeño, etc. Among all the variants of son, there's huapango, and there are two types generally that people identify. One is huapango huasteco, and that's the more popular one. That's the one that made it to the silver screen during the golden age of Mexican cinema. You remember, you know, those immortal stars like Pedro Infante, Jorge Negrete, belting out huapangos, right? They were playing huapango huasteco. Another variant of huapango is what I've done work on, huapango arribeño. And so it's string music, two fiddles, a jarana or vihuela, and a guitarra quinta huapanguera, which is also played in huapango huasteco. So four musicians, stringed instruments, and two things that really distinguish it from a lot of the other styles of son is, one, that the primary lyrical poetic convention is the décima. So you find the décima in different parts of Mexico and in different styles of music, but in huapango arribeño, that's the centerpiece of the poetics. It's the décima. That's primarily what the trovadores, the person who sings mainly is el trovador, the troubadour, the poet, uses the décima. Second thing is the ideal kind of performance context for this music is what they call a topada, from the verb topar, to collide with. And what that is, it's this marathon musical and poetic duel between two Arribeño groups, and that happens for hours. So the way I talk about it when I teach and talk to my students about this is like, well, you know, like hip-hop ciphers, you know, where you, mm-hmm. you do battles, right? That, you know, imagine that, but for 10 hours, 12 hours, and it's two groups and they're going back and forth, right?
And what type of topics do they touch?
Yeah, everything under the sun, really. So what's really fascinating, among one of the things that's fascinating about this music is the extensive repertoire that musicians have to sort of wield through memory, but also improvising. And so the topics of poesía, of poetics, in topadas and otherwise, depends on the context. So I always give a couple of examples. And like, well, if musicians are going to go play and celebrate an ejido, well, they're probably going to talk about not just that community, but the Mexican Revolution, for instance, right? If they're going to play a wedding, they're probably going to look to sort of liturgy, and they're going to talk about paraíso terrenal and all these other things, right, to talk to sort of celebrate the union between the couple. If so that's quite specific there. If it's just a topada and you know, they are sort of open for debate in terms of what's going to be talked about, anything can really come up. And there, you know, musicians, poets, you know, they have to have a repertoire. They have to be ready to respond to people's questions. So one example, I was just in Hichu, Guanajuato, where there's a topada to celebrate the new year every year. I was just there. I've been going for years. So as the poets are kind of dialoguing, debating over the course of the evening, one of the big topics of debate was the recent election in Mexico and the current state of Mexican politics. AMLO, all the rest of it. You know, ¿qué opinas tú de qué sé yo, right? And then on it went. And this is really wonderful way in which people, you know, and these musicians are in that true sense of troubadour, right? That you give the sort of lended significance to the word, right? Let's have a conversation. Let's talk about things. And so any topics can really come up.
Alex, your book Sounds of Crossing has been received with great accolades. Can you tell us a little bit about how this book came to be, and also what do you go into?
Yeah, so the book is the sort of research that I mentioned, which began in Austin, Texas, and then was in, you know, different places. I did some of the research in Mississippi, mainly Texas, a lot of it in Mexico. And it was when I was studying anthropology, my PhD in anthropology at the University of Texas. This is sourced from my dissertation, basically. So it was for the course of about a decade doing the research. And to go back to your first question, in terms of you know, how I connected to the music, the way this research came about actually was I sort of fell into it as a musician. I didn't, you know, find this stuff and want to do work on it. I like I said, I connected with musicians and I started playing because I wanted to learn. Mm-hmm. And there I was in Austin and these other places playing alongside huapangueros, learning from them, learning the craft, learning the music. And through the course of just being a musician, all these questions started to emerge for me about the migrant experience, because most of these musicians are migrants from that area of Mexico living in the United States, many of them undocumented. And so listening to their stories, their experiences, a lot of questions sort of started to come up for me, and that turned into research. And so what I did was I was in Mexico for about a year, but I would go back and forth for a number of years, but, you know, doing research also in the U.S. And, you know, the book is called Sounds of Crossing, and part of the idea there is, you know, how do migrants lend meaning to their migration through music, and how does that music travel with them in a really embodied way? Like, they are taking this music to where they're going. But also how they use music and poetics to close distances. So, you know, to think about what's in there, an introduction to the music. There is a discussion about the landscape of Mexican culture, Mexican music, and nationalism. There's a lot about so the communities in Mexico, in the United States, a number of different musicians. And then I dig into the social significance of what's happening in performance. And so one example of this Sounds of Crossing, how people close in distances, is I focus a fair amount on improvised saludados, or greetings mm-hmm. in decima form, you know, and how, for instance, you know, someone can be in San Luis Potosí and request a saludado for someone who's in Tennessee, right, and vice versa, right?
And this is happening in transnational communities?
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, someone, you know, an example I talked about is someone who's in a topada in San Luis Potosí and goes up to the musician, to the poet, and says, hey, you know, me puede trobar un saludado, can you improvise a greeting to X person? And that's common, you know, that you always hear that. But it was fascinating to me to think through, yeah, but they're not asking to say hello to someone who's there. Mm-hmm. They're saying, this person's in Tennessee. Can you say hi to them? And without hesitation, these musicians do it.
They improvise a verse.
Right, yeah. Exactly. But there was no question about the feasibility of, like, well, can this person's not here. Can they hear this? Or the questions about how does sound travel and dissipate over. It's like, it was, like, done without hesitation. And a number of those instances to me were, I came to find, and as I kept speaking to people, are about closing distances in ways that invoke memories, invoke experiences, invoke ideas, where it's not about whether that person who is intended for can hear it, but rather it's about how the memory of them or their presence is brought into that space at that time. And this was consistent. And so I was like, there's something happening here that is magical in a way, but that they're thinking through themselves through performance. It's theoretical, it's engaged, it's art, it's all these things. And I was hooked. I was like, okay. And so I just kept doing the work and kept writing and had building relationships and experiences, and a lot of it is in there.
And are there any important figures in this book of musicians or groups?
Yeah, there are a number that I sort of trace out and talk about, you know, their personal stories, them as artists and such. One in particular is Guillermo Velázquez. Guillermo Velázquez is a poet, practitioner, trovador, troubadour from Guanajuato, Hichu, Guanajuato. And he has a group called Los Leones de la Sierra de Hichu, and they've been active since the late 70s. And I tell that story. You know, how did he become a practitioner? How did he, become a poet? You know, his experiences as a migrant himself, a laborer between Guanajuato and Mexico City, and etc. And I mention him just like a number of other people, but I mention him because he's very well known. Mm. So yeah.
And Alex, can you tell us, just to conclude, two things? I want to know. I know that you had the experience of producing also. Can you tell us how that project
Sure.
to be?
Yeah, I got the opportunity to work with Guillermo Velázquez in the studio through Smithsonian Folkways. Mm. And so that was an opportunity of a lifetime because, when you do work on expressive culture, in this case music or something like that, you're always curious, and it's sort of the ideal scenario that, like, this thing that you're interested in, someone else, especially of that caliber, like the Smithsonian, would also take interest in it and be like, hey, we want to work with you on that. And there we were. Dan Sheehy, who was at the time the curator of Folkways, we kind of struck up a relationship, and I, floated this idea, and he was like, let's go for it. So it was a 4-year-long project through Smithsonian Folkways that's part of their Tradiciones series, where they've recorded a number of musics from Latin America. And they've done a lot of stuff in Mexico, but they've never recorded Huapango Ribeño. And so there we were, 4 years. We went down, we found a studio, we spoke with musicians, everybody's on board. We later on went and recorded and did all the post-production stuff. And so as a producer, that was great, working in the studio, assembling things, the content of the record, working with musicians and the engineers and all the rest of it. But one really cool thing that I got to do, which... again, was this great opportunity. Like, I got to write the liner notes for this record. And so that's one of the things that people love, and I too love about Folkways records, is those liner notes, because they tell you the story, they give you a history, they whatever. So I was able to do that, and it was this great experience because it was, how to distill like this into, to liner notes, right? To give a sense of history, who is this group, and why is this music important, and tell the story behind it. And I was able to do that. had that experience, and so it was great. It took 4 years, and it was amazing. You know, from someone who grew up listening to Get On With Alexis on tape, right? You know, to 30 some odd years later, I'm making a record with him. Was just very special for me, but you know, this amazing experience that, you know, it kind of in conjunction with the book. Yeah.
And do you have a sense of what is the future of Huapango Ribeño here in the U.S.?
Sure. You know, I find that there just seems to be more and more connectivity between the communities here in the States and Mexico, and so what that kind of generates is more people playing the music and using it, you know, to kind of imagine their connection across borders in different ways, either just in this more conceptual way that I just talked about, or in really material ways, like, you know, organizing dances for hometown associations and things like that. So you see the music sort of participating in this, you know, in this world more and more, and you see the emergence of young musicians. Yeah, mm-hmm. And so that's great. That's great. It's great.
And just to conclude, thank you so much for
no, thank
coming
you.
Yeah. In college.
thank you for being
here with the students, the community here in Lehman College.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you for being part of this great project.
Yeah, no, thank you.
So interesting, and for sharing your experience and just this product of love, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So thank you, and thank you for joining us for one special edition from Lehman College of the Mexican Studies Oral History Project.
Hi, I'm Lawrence Mays for Best of the Bronx. Tucked into the Mott Haven area of the South Bronx, or SoBro, artists, filmmakers, and restaurateurs are revving up this former industrial zone and fueling the cultural renaissance of the Bronx.
Bronx Art Space really started because there was a lot of energy here. People wanted to do things. And then we realized how many artists there were in the Bronx that were very underrepresented.
The Clock Bar is a Manhattan-style bar up here in the South Bronx. What we offer here is more of an upscale bar without the pretentiousness, same comfortable, homey, great cocktails, really delicious food.
To get here, take the 6 train to 3rd Ave, 138th Street, and look for the clock. See you next time for more Best of the Bronx.
Bienvenidos a una edición especial del proyecto de Historia Oral del Instituto de Estudios Mexicanos de CUNY. En esta ocasión nos encontramos aquí en el Museo de Brooklyn con la exposición especial de Frida Kahlo, Las apariencias engañan. Y en esta ocasión nos acompaña la directora del Museo Frida y el Museo Anahuacalli, Hilda Trujillo. Gracias por acompañarnos, gracias por venir a Nueva York. Platícanos un poco de cómo surgió esta idea de traer a Frida a Nueva York.
Mira, esta exposición es producto de mucho trabajo, de muchos años, de mucho esfuerzo, desde que abrimos en 2003 los baños de la Casa Azul. Y ahí encontramos más de 22,000 documentos, miles de fotografías, textiles. Tardamos 10 años en clasificar y restaurar con el apoyo de don Alfredo Harp e Isabel Graham Porrúa, quienes generosamente nos dieron el apoyo económico para hacerlo. Y luego hicimos la exposición con este título en la Casa Azul, muy exitosa, no podíamos sacar las casas porque los objetos, porque Diego Rivera dejó un testamento que dice que nada puede salir de la casa o de la Anahuacalli. Sin embargo, los abogados encontraron ahí un resquicio. Todo lo que está en los baños no está en el testamento, entonces sí puede salir. Después de eso, dado que el Anglo Mexican Foundation nos había ayudado para hacer la exposición en la Casa Azul, pues se pensó primero en Londres para hacer la exposición, en el Victoria and Albert, con gran éxito, y enseguida los vestidos iban a México a descansar junto con las fotografías, los exvotos. Pero la directora del Museo de Brooklyn, que es insistente, tenaz, nos convenció. Y había un argumento muy bien, más importante para mí, que es: hoy las comunidades mexicanas en Estados Unidos y las comunidades latinas sí. En general, tienen que sentir el orgullo de la fuerza de sus culturas, de sus artistas, para estar fuerte en estos momentos, para sentirse parte de eso, para conocer sus raíces, sentirse orgullosos, darles armas que da justo el arte y la cultura para tender puentes, para darles que se sientan reconocidos y tengan elementos con que salir adelante. Así que eso fue lo que nos motivó más. Y también la relación tan cercana que Frida Kahlo tuvo con Nueva York.
Claro, platícanos un poco sobre eso, porque existe esta relación entre Frida Kahlo específicamente y la ciudad de Nueva York.
Sí, mira, fíjate que Frida vino a Nueva York por primera vez cuando Diego Rivera estaba pintando el mural de Rockefeller en el Lincoln Center, sí. Y que después fue destruido. En ese periodo hay unas imágenes de Frida pintando en el Central Park, también algunos dibujos, que hace ensayos para representar a la Estatua de la Libertad, y después sí. Ella pretendía hacer un óleo que nunca terminó. Hay otro suceso importante cuando la galería de Julian Levy la invita a exponer en 1938. De esa época es su primera y única gran exposición internacional. Hay una foto testimonio donde ella está con sus brazos aquí y desnudos sus pechos, que se la toma Julian Levy porque fueron novios. También Frida vivió aquí en Nueva York 8 meses, 9 meses, después de que encuentra a Diego Rivera con su hermana, engañándolos, y se divorcian. Ella tenía un pretendiente, un gran amor, Nicholas Murray, uno de los mejores fotógrafos de Nueva York, sí. De Harper Bazaar. Le tomó unas fotos muy bonitas aquí, icónicas, que son las más hermosas fotos que están tomadas en Nueva York. Pero luego la deja porque no quiso casarse con una mujer enferma. Y ella realiza algunas obras aquí, pero dos de las más importantes, una es Mi vestido cuelga ahí, de esta ciudad de Nueva York, es hermosísimo. Y el otro es tres, uno que tiene el MoMA, cuando ella se corta el pelo, justamente después del engaño de Diego,
con su hermana.
Que el MoMA, el Museo de Arte Moderno de Nueva York, nunca presta, y esta vez lo prestó y está en esta exposición, hay que verlo, vale mucho la pena. La otra obra es cuando Nicholas Murray la deja, y ella hace este cuadro hermoso, autorretrato, donde está el changuito tejiéndole un collar de espinas y ella está llorando. Se lo regala, pues, con el dolor porque la deja, ¿verdad? En fin, que hay una, al mismo tiempo que hay una relación ambigua, pero de mucho cariño y respeto por Nueva York, y también de mucho de la ironía negra. Tenía un sentido humor muy negro e irónico, Frida, donde dice, ay, estos gringos, sí. ¿No? Pero de hecho,
una parte de la exposición está titulada...
Los ¿cómo? Gringos, qué bonito, ¿no?
Sí, ¿verdad?
Refleja su sentido del humor. Tiene un poema, para que la conozcan, que dice, quise ahogar mis penas en alcohol y las canejas aprendieron a nada. Era tremenda. Pero como una mujer que tuvo más de 30 operaciones, que tuvo poliomielitis, logra... transformar el dolor en obra de arte, en vida. Y eso es lo que vas a ver en esta exposición. El universo íntimo de Frida Kahlo, como lo hemos llamado, y que es que te explica por qué Frida llega a pintar con tal intensidad, con tal originalidad. Te explica cómo ella se convierte en una obra de arte en sí misma para ocultar su discapacidad. Sí. Cómo también abraza su parte masculina, ¿no? Siempre no tiene ataduras sociales.
Exacto.
Hay un tema de donde las mujeres se identifican con esta mujer tan libre, y tan inquieta intelectualmente, con preocupaciones sociales, ¿no? Por los menos favorecidos. Soy Frida responde a muchas inquietudes sociales. Por eso esta exposición va a ser un éxito y porque además, de verdad, Frida es una pintora icónica.
Sí, y fue un éxito también la apertura, ¿cierto? Vinieron personalidades.
La inauguración.
La inauguración.
Sí, vino Javier Camarena, que triunfó antier en el Met, en el Metropolitan Opera House. Vinieron los hijos de Plácido Domingo, el arquitecto Rodkin, muchas personalidades, artistas, pero que vinieron a celebrar, a decir, estamos aquí en este evento que refleja una de las artistas, no es la única, por supuesto, pero claro, una de las artistas mexicanas, que es un evento de mucho nivel y para compartir el orgullo de ser mexicanos.
Exacto. Y como tú sabes, en el Instituto de Estudios Mexicanos de aquí de la Universidad de la Ciudad de Nueva York, nuestra misión es esa, precisamente, poder contactar a la comunidad con su cultura, también hacer investigación sobre lo que pasa en México y aquí con la diáspora mexicana en Estados Unidos. También promover a estudiantes a que tengan acceso a educación superior y también hacer vínculos entre las dos naciones, ¿no? Entonces, hoy fue un día muy especial para nosotros porque nos invitaste a nuestro programa de becarios. ¿Por qué era para ti importante invitarlos?
Bueno, justamente por lo que fue importante traer y por lo que nos convencieron para traer esta exposición a Brooklyn, Brooklyn, Nueva York, que es darles que los chicos, los dreamers, la comunidad mexicana encuentre sus raíces, latino también, encuentre sus raíces, su riqueza cultural, artística, que tenemos, que nos hace tender puentes, ¿verdad?, entre los países y que puedan además compartirlo con líderes, con estudiantes y decirle, estos somos nosotros, tenemos mucho que dar. Y pienso que fue hoy que los veía con sus caritas entusiasmados, ¿verdad?, y que van a poder compartir esta experiencia, y que para estos chicos que quieren estudiar, que tienen muchas ganas de estudiar y que no se les puede negar su derecho, son jóvenes con aspiraciones, que vivan los dreamers, hay que apoyarlos, y eso es lo que yo quería, y justamente espero que esta exposición pueda ayudar a que ellos se sientan muy orgullosos de lo que es su país.
Muchas gracias, claro que sí, y la verdad te lo agradezco muchísimo. Y ya para concluir, me gustaría que dieras un mensaje para invitar a la comunidad también de aquí, de Nueva York, a la comunidad mexicana, y no nada más la mexicana, a la comunidad en general, para que vengan.
Bueno, es que es una exposición que no se pueden perder, la han pedido más de 20 países, es única, es de muy alto nivel, y va a ser irrepetible, vengan y la van a disfrutar enormemente, porque si no tendrían que ir a la Casa Azul a México, ahora la tienen aquí, y espero que puedan venir, que puedan encontrarse con estas maravillosas obras y estos atuendos, objetos personales que te reflejan quién es Frida Kahlo.
Muchas gracias, Hilda. Y pues a ustedes muchísimas gracias, soy José Higuera, director operativo del Instituto de Estudios Mexicanos de la Universidad de la Ciudad de Nueva York. Y por favor acompáñenos aquí, visiten a la exposición de Frida Kahlo y los esperamos en el siguiente episodio del proyecto de Historia Oral del Instituto de Estudios Mexicanos. Gracias.